Discuss about algorithmic approach to model a probabilistic phenomenon, that means probabilistic modeling. How to perform a probabilistic modeling? That means you are having a problem which is having some kind of randomness, and some kind of event of interest would be there, and you have to find the probability of that event. So systematically you have to perform that. So I will perform that in 4 steps. So those steps we will discuss in detail, and you will see it will be really interesting, and it always simplify difficulty level of any probabilistic problem. You won't face any problem if you proceed in a very right way approach. So coming to outline of today's lecture, I would like to discuss first about probability law for continuous case. In the last class, we had already discussed about probability law for discrete case. We had gone through discrete uniform law as a equally likely of outcome. Like in short, you can say that in last class we had already discussed discrete, when sample space was discrete, that time we talk about the corresponding uniform law appears to be discrete uniform law. So, and if you further willing to translate it in term of more familiar kind of thing, then you can convert this discrete uniform law, you can call it equally likely outcomes. That means every outcome which is involved there in this corresponding self experiment, then every outcome is having the same probability. So equally likely, that is the meaning of equally likely outcome. So those things we had already discussed in last class. Due to this probability law, we come up with one explicit form of the probability measure. So it happens with respect to discrete sample space. So discrete sample space, if in a random experiment you come up with a sample space, that one is a discrete sample space, then you have to apply the corresponding probability law would be a discrete uniform law. And further, if you try to talk in detail, that would be nothing, just it is talking about equally likely outcome. Okay, so due to that, we had explicit form of probability measure of an event. Suppose A, you are taking, that one is event. So look out to what are the outcome there. So count the total number of outcome. So outcome which occurs in A, and divide the number of all possible outcome. That would be your probability of the event A. Outcomes in A. So we had already seen that in case of discrete sample space. But suppose your sample space is not discrete, it is continuous, then you will see continuous uniform law in different pattern. It will come with respect to a continuous set. So that would be really interesting. There would be the probability measure would be defined in a different fashion. Definition would be different. So that concept we will discuss in detail. After that, we will talk about algorithm for probabilistic modeling. So, okay. And if time permits, then we will go to discuss few more example. Okay. So all these are part of today's lecture. Coming to probabilistic law, that as I mentioned, today we will discuss about continuous sample space, and here the continuous sample space or continuous uniform law, it can be translated into equally likely event. Here remember that we are not talking about equally likely outcomes. The outcome was the elementary part of discrete sample space, but when you talk about a continuous sample space, then simply we can't talk about equally likely outcome. There would be some issue. That issue also I will highlight. As I had already told that in last class, like if you are dealing with a interval or a subset of real number containing some interval, then what is happening that you do perform partitioning. So that partitioning always happens in such a way, the partition member happens to be sub intervals. subintervals, and in that process, if you exhaust all those subintervals and take union of those, then what is happening here, you will get the original subset of real number of interval. So that means partitioning of continuous set, generally how we do, we don't do through point-wise approach. So we always, if you say come up with one partition of interval, then it contains generally partition we define like this way. It contains n point, n plus 1 point starting from x0 to x1, x2, and it will go on up to xn. So depends, n is your choice, what n you are, how many partition memory you want to take. So you can put it here n. N here in suffix, so n is also variable. So here generally x naught happens to be the starting point a, and xn happens to be the last point, terminal point b. And apart from that, we always observe order property among the partition point. That means x naught would be strictly less than x1, x1 would be strictly less than x2, and likewise it will go xn minus 1 would be strictly less x than xn. Okay, xn happens to be b itself. So that these things are meaning of partition. Simply I would like to say that recall the partition concept. Okay, and here partition, these partition members satisfy this condition. Apart from that, what we observe, we observe that if you take union of these sub interval x, call it xk minus 1 to xk, and if you take union of all these sub interval, here k varies from 1 to n. So here it would be 1 to n. So what would be union of these sub interval, anyone? What would be this for being a partition? Yes, not, it would be not one, it would be in the interval AB itself. What interval we have taken it, union would be like, if you geometrically willing to visualize, then you can visualize this sub interval like this way. So you are having this point is A, that we denoted by x naught or equal to, this one is equal to A, and the last point we denoted by B, that happens to be xn, nth member of the partition. In between x1, x2, and this point is xn minus 1. All these are coming. So one property, these have to satisfy this kind of things, have to satisfy union must be equal to AB, that we are calling it exhaustiveness. And third property is that mutually exclusiveness is coming, except the what we call it boundary point, that the boundary point of each sub interval. So in place of exclude boundary point, if you are excluding boundary point, and if you are taking any two open interval as interval implied from that those sub interval, then definitely it would be intersection would be non empty if you are taking any two, j minus x, j minus 1, xj. So intersection would be non-empty. Here k varies from, k on j varies from 1 to n. So that's why it is meaning of partition. Partition of a set, you might have already seen that this one is talking about partition of an interval kind of set. And partition of a set also we will discuss further again, because that will be very interesting in order to find total probability of an event, and it is playing very important role also in Bayes theorem. So those partition of a set, a partition of a continuous set, those things will come in regularly. So here you can easily see that whenever you try to partition a continuous set, then the elementary set happens to be interval or subinterval. And simply, if you talk about interval or subinterval, it is not containing a single element. It is containing infinitely many elements between those terminal points. Okay, so simply an interval, we can't say an outcome. When we are talking about sample space, interval can't be outcome, because interval definitely contains various outcome. So that's why we are calling this subinterval as event. So that's why here, in case of continuous sample space, we have to come up with the uniform law that would be equally likely event kind of situation would come here. Okay, so it might be clear why I had taken event concept here. So for this concept, I come up with all these partition concept. Okay, now we are discussing further. Any question till now? Okay, fine. So we will go forward. Okay, suppose I'm just starting with an example. Suppose we are having a wheel of fortune, and we are spinning that wheel of fortune, and we record the reading, that reading recorded by pointer, that means we record the position of pointer on the circumference. So wheel of fortune, it happens to be a circular kind of approach. Okay. So here center is this one, and this pointer is striking at the circumference, and we are reading on the circumference. Okay, with each spin, just spin one at a time and try to observe where that counter is going to stop. Okay, where the counter is going to hit finally after one spin on the circumference, and we assume that the length of circumference is 1, length is 1, unit length circumference that we are taking, and the wheel is unbiased. That means it is not like that there is some kind of biasness is there. That means it is biasness is coming from that owner of the wheel. It is not like that. It is completely unbiased. It is behaving equally with respect to each spin. Okay, so that's the unbiased. So the position is presumably equally likely to take any value in the interval 0 to 1. So if you spin the wheel, then it will take any value between the interval 0 1. So omega is a number, it is a number between 0 1, our outcome. Omega is an outcome with respect to each experiment, we are getting an output. So that's why omega is an output, or it is a number between 0 and 1. So a point, simply we can say that it is a point between 0 and 1. Geometrically we can say like that. Okay, so that is a wheel of fortune is continuously calibrated value from 0 to 1. So simply this set 0 to 1, it is not countable, it is uncountable set. We can't put this one in a single sequence that I had already mentioned in last class. Okay, we can't put this one in a single sequence, it is not equal to, we can't put. So simply it is directly a continuum set or continuous set, we can say that like that. So each omega may be any number between 0 and 1. It is not like that omega 1, omega 2, omega 3 kind of things. There is no sequential order of the element here. We can't put a sequence, find a sequence in which all the element of this one would be fitted. We can't do that. So if you suppose someone is saying that, no, can we take a sequence from 0 1? Yeah, there are many sequences in 0, 1. One is 1 by n, another one would be n plus 1, 1 by n plus 1. And there are various sequences in this interval. So not a single sequence, there are various sequence, so it is not possible to simply put this interval into a single sequence. So that's why this one is a 0, 1 is an uncountable set. So we have to come up with a uniform law in case of continuous sample space, and that we are calling it here continuous probability. What we do here in continuous probability, we are assigning probability to certain basic event. Certain basic event. We are not assigning probability to outcome, that elementary kind of that with respect to each experiment, what outcome we are getting. We are not assigning probability to outcome. In place of that, we are assigning probability to event, basic event. Remember, event, we are talking about basic event. As per discussion of partition of an interval, what I had already discussed. So through partition of interval, you will come up with basic event that would be of interest. So this basic event, what happens, it is just opposite of, it is not related with what outcome directly. It is having a continuum of outcomes, simply we can say that, like in discrete probability or in case of discrete sample space, what we had defined outcome. We had defined outcome and we were talking about uniform law through equilibrium outcomes. Equilibrium outcome. So you won't talk here in case of continuous probability or continuous sample space. We'll talk our basic element that would come with respect to sub interval. With that, after doing a lot of partition refinement, keep on doing refinement till possible. As per your choice, as much as refinement you can do possible, you can do that. So that through all the possible refinement of the partition, you will get ultimately a basic interval event as a interval, sub interval. Simply that I would like to say that. So simply in that case, if a basic event happened to be an interval, and suppose then how we can assign probability to that interval, then in that case, suppose interval AB, it happens to be a basic event of this 0 1, that means it is coming with respect to some partition. This AB is coming with respect to some partition, then what is the probability of this one? Through this uniform law, what is the probability of this one? So this probability would be just proportional to or equal to length of the that sub interval B minus A. So B minus A would be the probability of this basic event. So simply, I'm not calling it, can't be an outcome. It is an event, because it is containing infinitely many outcomes. So that's why it is an event. And this event, how we can assign probability? We can assign probability through difference of the or simply with respect to length of the corresponding subinterval we are trying to. Now, next question is coming, that what does it mean here for the equally likely situation? Then last class, as I mentioned that, so there are various subinterval of, suppose this given set, a continuous set, call it continuous set. If there are various, like you can call it x naught, x1, another one is x1, x2. Suppose you have taken n number of subintervals, such subinterval. And we are putting that each one is having the same length. We are putting that each one is having same length. That means the difference between xk minus 1 and xk from xk, it is what? It is delta common. K varies from 1 to n. So through equally likely assumption, this equally likely assumption, we will say that if you are taking any interval and you are asking what is the probability of that interval, then probability of that interval would be, so take interval like xk minus 1 to xk. What would be the probability of this interval? It would be equal to delta. Now, anyone may suggest what would be the value of delta? What would be the value of delta in term of if number of partitions? What would be delta? Anyone? Recall the partition concept. What would be delta here? Yeah, very nice. It would be 1 by n. Because we have taken n number of partition, n number of points, sub intervals, which form a partition of the given interval 0, 1. So that's where delta would be 1 by n. Suppose we take another interval, like simply you can say that delta is what different length of the actual given set divided by how many partition point you are taking, how many sub interval you are taking. In that means how many sub interval that given set, the number of total sub interval in which the given set has been divided into. So that's where that is the count talking. So here you can say that it is probability of a sub interval of length delta. It is 1 by n equal to length of that the corresponding sub interval 1 by n. So if you take talk about what is the probability of this one, probability of this one would be also 1 by n, probability of this one would be also 1 by n, probability of this one would be also 1 by n. So all these sub interval is having same probability 1 by n. If you sum up all these probability, it would come equal to 1. So it is satisfying all the normalizing condition, everything is satisfied here. So this is the approach in case of continuous sample space or continuous probability, you can call it, when your sample space happen to be a continuous set. Okay, so just I will take few example here and then I will go to discuss further. So suppose again same waiting time example, waiting time for bus we will talk about. So suppose we are waiting for a bus at the bus stop and we make the modeling assumption that the bus always comes within at most 1 hour. But that if you are waiting near at a bus stop, then one bus always you will get bus which is coming within at most 1 hour. That means one bus has passed, the another bus will take at most 1 hour, 1 hour difference, and it is equally likely to come at any time within this hour. And that means there is a 1 hour duration. In this 1 hour duration, at any moment of time bus may come. Okay, equally likely situation. So here we want to go interval wise, outcome wise, we will go again interval wise here. So that's where interval wise approach. So we do partition of the given here. So simply due to this, we will come up with sample space. It would be just an open close interval 0, 1. We are having, this is the sample space of this experiment. Now, definitely you will get one bus within 1 hour. It is already mentioned here. That's why this is the sample of space. So what we do, consider for the example, we are having two subset A and B of this sample of space. So you will what A is this one at time x to x plus epsilon. B is talking about y to y plus epsilon. So both A and B is having same what we call it same length. So that's way you can easily calculate the probability of A and B through equally likely assumption, and that bus what say bus arrive at a time in the set A should be what would be probability of A? It would be just length of A. And what is the length of A? It is epsilon. Likewise, what is the length, probability of B? That would be also probability of B. It would be, that means bus will arrive in this interval B, it would be also length of the interval epsilon. So suppose if I'm asking that in the same question, I'm saying that suppose we are taking just partitioning of this interval into two sub interval. If you are just having two sub interval, then what is the this point is call it 1 by 2. Okay, then what is the probability of 0 to 1 by 2? What would be probability of this one? Yeah, very nice. And likewise, why it is half? Because of equally likely situation. Due to equally likely situation or due to uniform law, we are saying that probability would be half. Similarly, probability of 1 by 2 So it is coming with respect to equilibrium uniform law. Because of that, we are able to say that probability would be half. That's why we have taken that assumption. Now, suppose you do one more thing is that you partition this unit interval into three subinterval. 0 to 1, you are partitioning into three subinterval. 1 by 3, 2 by 3. Okay, then if I ask, suppose call this subinterval A1, this subinterval A2, remember that each subinterval is having equal length. So why we are taking equal length? Due to that uniform law. Uniform law, we do partition. If you take a different non-uniform, then things would be complicated. So non-uniform things we will study later. So here simply we will say that if you take any subinterval AI, then probability would be what? What would be probability? Anyone? Yeah, very nice. 1 by 3. 4. So for I equal to 1 to n. So simply uniform law is coming here. Why it is happening? Because of uniform law. That is the meaning of uniform law in case of continuous probability or simply a random experiment with continuous sample space. Okay, few more thing about this, like just we'll do some practical thing. So for example, we can compute the following probability. That means that the bus come within first 15 minutes. Then what would be probability of that? That's first 15 minutes. If you try to convert that into hour, what would be this one? 0.25. That means 1/4 of 1 hour. Okay, so that's what would be probability of this? It would be just 0.25. Likewise, suppose the probability that bus come exactly at a given time x, at exactly, remember that exactly word is mentioned here, focus on here, exactly word, so at a point. So in that case, what would be probability of that x, a single point x, what would be probability? It is zero. Is it possible that bus will come exactly the given time? Is it possible? That one is a very rare kind of event. Rarely it is possible. So that way, if one event is rare, that means it is simply impossible kind of thing. Simply we say that it is impossible to impossible that bus will come exactly at a time. Definitely there would be some kind of plus minus deviation from the exact time. So that deviation will measure the probability. So that's why someone is saying that in case of continuous probability, what is the probability of a single point? It is always equal to zero. Probability of single point is always equal to zero. So you may have already seen the dart game. The dart game. When a player is getting 10 points, anyone? Whether that player is hitting exactly at a point or somewhere in the vicinity of that point. Area, definitely there is a positive area. It is not like that point is having zero area. And it is not like that exactly a single point if that player is hitting, then that player will get 10 points. So if that player is hitting anywhere here within this area, then that player will get 10 points. So that's why we never take a single point. We always take area wise approach. So that's why here probability of hitting in this would give 10 point. If someone is hitting here, then that player will get 9 point. Likewise, it is coming, so area wise. So that is the concept here coming here, because it is impossible to hit exactly at a point, exactly at a, somehow by luck, by chance it may happen, but that happens, that one is very rare kind of event or impossible kind of event. So that's why we are saying the probability of a single point in case of continuous sample space, or in case of continuous probability, it is always we take it equal to 0. I will highlight again it. If you are taking it non-zero, then you will face problem that it will just disobey the normalizing condition. Disobey the normalizing condition, that we will see it later. So due to this that Kolmogorov approach, that axiom of probability, what three set of axioms, in order to satisfy, we are taking in case of continuous probability, probability of a single point always happens to be zero. That is, if you guess in advance of the experiment that the bus will arrive exactly at time x, then you will always be wrong. No matter what number x you choose, always it would be wrong. You would be wrong. That is the concept of being zero. Okay, zero means not possible. So there are infinitely many times in the interval 0, 1, and which is equally likely. So each exact time must occur with probability zero. Each exact time must occur with probability zero. So the probability that the bus comes at first 15 minute, it would be what? At if someone is saying at first 15 minute, then just you have to add this plus minus 1 second. You have to add the error, some kind of tolerance you have to mention here, some kind of tolerance. That probability you can easily see that if you are taking that tolerance level very small, then probability would be very small. Probability is very small, very near about 15. If you are taking tolerance level 1, then probability you can see that it is very 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 rare kind of probability. Simply because if you keep on decreasing the tolerance level, then probability would keep on decreasing, finally it will go to zero. If exactness is coming, then finally it will go to zero. That is the concept. So the more precisely you are asked to guess the time the bus will arrive, the less likely it is that you will be correct. Less likely. So you can see that what is meaning of P is a probability, denote probability, and probability always lies between 0 to 1. Okay, and someone is defining log P, negative log P, because P is a number between 0 to 1. Then tell me, if P is very small, then what would be this quantity? What would be this quantity? If P is very small, then what would be this log of negative log of P? Anyone? Just see the plot of logarithmic function. So log P, it is coming like this way. So negative log P, it will come like this way. At 1, it is 0. It would be very large. So that's why people are calling, there is a specific name of this negative log P that we are calling information. We will see that it will have application in random process. It is very much essential and to define information. And also if you are coming with what we call it estimator of any parameter, then we have to compute the information as well. So this one is, we have to define best estimator or most efficient estimator. So those things will demand to understand this concept, negative of log P. Okay, this we are calling general information, how much information it is containing. If P is very less, that means a lot of randomness. That means if you take negative log of P, then that would be information. That means if the P is very less, that means probability is very less, means simply lot of information is there. If probability is equal to 1, that means there is no information. That one is a certain kind of event. So there would be no information. It is a very much certain kind of event. So that's why once I had told that if you are having any video lecture, then you too, and that one is having very less number of view, then it simply says that video lecture will have a lot of information. Lot of information. So that's why try to collect those information. That's why from this logic I had given that idea. So the more so that everything I have with the probabilistic algorithm for probabilistic modeling. Okay, so what is algorithm for probabilistic modeling? So suppose you are having a random experiment, random phenomena, then how you can model that random phenomena in mathematical perspective. So in order to model that random phenomena, you have to come up with three ingredients. One is all possible, a specification of all possible outcomes, and that one we are calling sample space. Then you have to come up with a probability measure that satisfies three important axioms. One, two, three important axioms we had already discussed. Okay, then we have to come up with probability law, whether it is a discrete probability law or continuous, depends upon the nature of sample space. So we have to come up with these three in order to perform probabilistic modeling. Okay, so here one visual I can talk like this way. So you are having an experiment. This is the experiment. You perform the experiment and you specified all the possible outcome, and hence you got sample space. Once you are having sample space, then just understand the outcome, what is the outcome, and take few outcome, define event. Define the some possible outcome is giving an event. Take some possible outcome from here, that one is going to define event A. Likewise, take other possible outcome, and it will define another event B. Now, you find the probability of A using that uniform principle. Uniform principle, you will come up with probability of A. If A happens to be a sigma, is a this omega is a finite set, then A would be definitely finite. Then that time we will calculate, we will try to zoom out A and try to see what kind of outcome there, and we will through equivalent likely probability, we will sum up the probability of all those outcomes in order to get probability of A. If A is an interval, then we have to partition that, and we have to see through that uniform law and what kind of basic sub interval are there, or basic element event are there, and we'll calculate the probability and sum up all those, and you will get probability of A. So anyhow, we will get probability of A, whether it is a sigma is omega is a discrete or continuous, depends upon that. That just justify the approach, what approach you want to proceed, whether discrete or continuous approach, and hence we will get probability, and just these are the probability. So both different event, we will get different probability. Okay, now the coming to algorithm, in order to completely find the desired probability. So what is the algorithm? In the first step, what we do, we identify all possible outcomes, and hence we are getting sample space. And then in second step, what we do, we define event of interest from the question. Whatever question is given there, then we define event of interest, generally we denote it by E or A. E is taken from event word, or A you can do. Okay, afterward what we do, in the step 3, we try to determine probability of each outcome. If it is possible, if that sample space is discrete, then we'll try to find probability of each outcome. If sample space is continuous, then we will try to find probability of each basic event. So we'll come up with idea of basic event. So it vary with respect to problem. We have to find probability of each basic element in case of continuous random continuous sample space, and in case of discrete we come up with determination of probability of each outcome. Afterward what we do, afterward finally we try to, once we are having idea of probability of each outcome or each basic outcome, then we will compute the probability of desired event, what we are willing to calculate, for which we are willing to calculate probability. So these are the 4 steps. I will take the same example, Monte Hall problem. That means the problem, it says that suppose you are on a game, so, and you are given this choice that there are 3 doors. Okay, behind one door there is a car, that we are calling it prize. Behind the other doors there are goats. Okay, so what is happening, that you pick a door, say it is number 1, and the host who knows what is behind the doors open another door, say number 3, then which is having a goat. Okay, then he suggests you, do you want to pick door number 2? He is giving suggestion. Do you want to pick number door number two? Once you have selected door number one, that time after seeing door number three, he is giving suggestion. Would you like to pick door number two? Because that host is having idea what is behind what door. Okay. So here, what is question? Question is coming that you have to find the probability with which the player wins. You have to find the probability with which the player wins by switching. So here, this one is one event of interest. That means player wins by switching. It is one event of interest. There would be various event of interest here. You can divide, but one event of interest. This one is you have to define. So this is you have to find the probability of this one. So how you can find the probability of this one? So same approach that here you have to do. First step that you have to quantify all the. You have to identify all the outcomes. Then you have to come up with event of interest. Then you have to compute outcomes, probability of outcomes, each outcome. Then later you will get probability of event. So here, just in order to see what is the outcome, how to define outcome, and for the purpose of identification outcome, you come up with what are the sub ingredient thing which is defining an outcome. So that's where first one is, you can see it here, as I had mentioned, that the door which is hiding the car. Then second ingredient in order to define outcome, that second level information is coming, that the door the initially is chosen by the player. Okay, that means player selections. This one you can call it car location. Another name you can call it car location. This number, this one is first layer of information. Second layer of information is that after that player's choice. This one is the second level of information. Then third layer of information is coming, that a host is revealing revealing about door, the door, God is there behind the door. So second is coming, and that host is coming from host, simply I would like to say that. So this combining these three layer of information, we will come up with outcome. So it is coming like the identification of outcome is coming like this way. So better, as I had mentioned, that we want proceed with door number one, door number two, door number three. In place of that, we will proceed with door A, door B, door C. So this representation will be much better. So what is the first layer of information? First layer of information is regarding the hiding of car behind some. There is one door behind which there is a car. So this, that one is the first layer of information, and that we are calling car location. So here, if you talk about probability of this occurrence of this one, it is 1/3 equally likely situation. Here simply we will put equally likely situation. Why? There are three, only three options. So it is discrete instance. So that's where equally likely discrete equally likely situation we will put it here. What is the second layer of information? The player's choice. Okay, that is the second layer of information, and hence what we will get. So we will got this second layer of information. So again, you call it, what is the, how we divide the probability? It would be 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. Again, it will come here. So finally, I will talk about computation later. So all these, how you, we are assigning probability to each branch of the layer. Okay, then third layer of information, it is saying that that host opens a door in order to reveal there is a goat. So due to that, we got this is all these are coming with respect to a third layer of information. Now in order to identify outcome, so how we can identify outcome? Each leaf, so these are the outcome, each leaf is outcome. So how we can get leaf? So suppose one example here, we can take it like this way. If the prize is behind door A and player is picking door A, and the in that case, what will happen? The host will have two options. Either host will open B or host will open C. Why host will do? Because host know that prize is behind door A, but player is not aware of that. So that's where host will only open those door behind which got it there. So that's where for host there are two options. Now, if you so that's where here in this case, so what are the possible outcome? It would be A, B, and here this outcome would be A, A, C. Suppose again another scenario that suppose car is behind door A and player is picking door B, then host is aware of the location of car. So host will not open A, host will open only C in order to say that to player that switch your option. That means so that's why in this case host will have only one option C with probability 1. So easily we can say that here with probability 1 host will open C. So what you will get? You will get event A, B, C. Likewise, if same situation, host is so player is opting for C, then host will open B, A, C, B. So outcome would be A, C, B. In that process, you can collect all the outcome and hence you got your sample space. This is the desired sample space of this problem. So once you are having idea of sample space, next job is you have to come up with event of interest. You have to identify what is the event of interest because you know about the outcomes. So in term of outcome, you can express events. Okay. So how you can identify outcomes? So you have to define an objective in order to identify an event. How you can define outcome? Define an objective. So one objective is that you what probability you are willing to find of what. So what is the probability of something? So here simply we can say that something would be what? It may be the player wins by switching one option. It may be the player initially picked the door that one is concealing the or hiding the prize. This one is the second option. Or it may be that prize is behind the door C, third option. So there are various options. So you may find probability of 1, you may find probability of 2, or you may find probability of 3. So any of these 1, 2, 3 may be event of interest. Depends upon if you forget the first question that it was related with what is the probability that player wins by switching. If we put that, then this would be the event of interest. If that one is not mentioned there, if I have just left to find the probability and everything is blank, then event of interest may be anything. Depends upon what situation you have to come up with. So it may be any of these three. Okay. So as we know, what event is? It is a collection of some possible outcome. I always just giving emphasis to this event always happens to be some possible outcome. So we have to define all these three event in term of outcome. So you have to look this event and what are the outcome there in those events. So we have to look. So how we will look? So suppose we start with this one. We are calling it first event. We are saying that okay, reverse the order. Better reverse the order. This one is 2, 1, this one 2, 3. So suppose first event of interest we are taking is the prize is behind door C. The prize is behind door C. So in this case, how we can identify the possible some possible outcome which are in C? So we have to identify those. This I have already written here. So here in the first layer information, we are following only branch C. There are three options A, B, C, but we are not taking these two. We are just following C, that prize is behind C. With respect to that, in second layer we will get three options. Then in third layer, what would happen if prize is behind C and player is opting for A? Then host definitely is not going to open C. Host will have only one option. What would be that? That would be B. So host will open door B with probability 1, and hence we will get event CAB. So that's where CAB is coming here. And in this situation, what we will get? CBA, likewise CCA, like CCB. So these are the four options when four outcomes are coming in the event when price is behind door C. So for these four outcome are coming. So easily you can identify what are the outcomes. Now if you talk about second event of interest, that suppose price is behind the door first pick by the player. Okay, so what situation is coming here in that case? The situation is like this way. If you try to see it like this way, so just here matter of interest in order to define event is the second layer. So suppose player is picking A. Okay, that means what does it mean? Car is behind the door A. So in that case, host will open either B or C. So that's why these two outcome would come with respect to this branch. Okay, like suppose host is the player is opting for C. In this case, host will come to know that car location is behind B, and hence host will open either A or C. Okay, so that's where these two event will come. Likewise, suppose player is here. I am saying that event of interest, it is defined by second layer. This event of interest, it is defined by first, second layer. So here, if player is opting for C, then what will happen? That host will open in the third layer, host will open either A or B. So this event would come. This outcome would come. If you bring all these six outcome in together, you are getting event 2. Likewise, if you are willing to define the event, third event, that the player wins by switching, that means what is the situation? The situation is coming like this way. First layer information, second layer is information. So here player wins by switching. So suppose player has opted for B, then what will happen? Then after seeing the host is seeing door C, host will say that switch option. Okay, so he will say switching, that's where host will see. So this layer of this outcome is coming. Likewise, all these outcome are coming. So these are the outcome with respect to third event of interest. Okay, these are the outcome. So I am just trying to compute the probability of each outcome. So branch wise we can see it like layer wise. So if you are in the first layer, then there are three options, equally likely situation is there. So that's where probability would be 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, 4 A, B, C. Okay, after that, if you are arriving here, then a player is having equally likely situation, the probability of probability that player will select this door, this door, this door, all equally likely situations, so 1/3, 1/3. But if you are coming here, then host is aware of that price is behind door A, so host will have only two options with equally likely situation, 1/2, 1/2 probability. Okay, so these are the corresponding probability. Like if we host is coming here, then host is having only one option, that two things has been already revealed to host, so host will open only C with probability 1. So all these are the probability that through branch wise we can see it. And what we do, the branch wise happens, that it is a proper sequential approach. So simply multiplication rule we will apply in order to compute probability of each outcome. These are the outcome leaf, these leaf are outcome, and we are computing these are the probability. One probability is this one, this, all these are the probability, all possible probability of each outcome. So we come up with all the possible probabilities of outcome. So all the for every possible outcome we come up with probability of the outcome. Okay, so we are having the probability. At last, what we will do, we will compute the probability of an event. So one event, what we are taking, that third one event, that the switching, it was related with that the event that player wins by switching, and that event is including these outcome. And so we know that each one is having probability 1/2, If you try to simplify, probability would be 1 by 9, something like that, if you simplify it in the branch. And that if you sum up all these probability, all are mutually exclusive. If you try to see, you can see that all are mutually exclusive. Due to that, just sum up the probability of these outcome and you will get your desired probability of event. This is the approach to compute probability of event of interest. So other thing we will discuss in next class. Anyone further having any question?